Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to AGDQ 2015. This stream is powered by Twitch. Up next is The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time Master Quest All Dungeons Run. My name's Katie V, and I'll be reading your donation comments. $100 donation from Trickermand. Moved my PC to my friend's place just to watch AGDQ all week. We've been doing that for the past few times now and simply love what you're doing. We've been looking forward for the Zelda runs all week, in particular Ocarina of Time. Gotta donate for that Zelda reverse boss race. Hope you guys enjoy this as much as us. We have a $100 donation from Yuyito. Donating for my wife, who was diagnosed with breast cancer last year and is currently going through chemo. I love seeing my hobby used to support a great cause. Thank you and good luck to all the runners.
Good to go? All right. So, what's the file name?
Yeah.
All right, so are you ready to go? All right, 3, 2, 1, go. So I guess we should start off with some introductions. I'm ZFG.
I am Moltov.
I'm Gregor Tixelkins.
I am Runner Guy.
So this
Wait,
is...
Wait, this is Daddy.
Oh. So this is Ocarina of Time Master Quest. This is a special version of Ocarina of Time that was only released as a pre-order bonus for Wind Waker. And so a lot of people don't know about it because it's a kind of obscure game, at least relative to normal Ocarina of Time. And this is the All Dungeons category. So I'm going to have to be beating all of the dungeons. That's Decatree, Dodongo's Cavern, Jabba Jabba's Belly, Forest Fire, Water, Shadow, and Spirit Temple, and then beating Ganon. And... So the main change in Master Quest is that all the dungeons are redesigned. So they're still the same basic dungeons. There's still Fire Temple, Water Temple, etc. But they have different paths you're supposed to go through the dungeons, different puzzles, different enemies that you have to fight. And so it makes it an interesting change of pace from normal Ocarina of Time runs. However, nothing else is changed. So everything in the overworld is completely the same. All of the mechanics are exactly the same. So you're still gonna be seeing a lot of the glitches you're familiar with if you've watched Ocarina of Time runs a lot, just used in some different ways in this run. Also, this is being played on the Japanese version, just for faster text, and this is also the GameCube version. Master Quest is actually only a GameCube game, and Ocarina of Time on GameCube in general has some interesting changes, mostly actually kind of bad. The resets are kind of slow. I will be resetting occasionally for save warping, which is useful for just saving and resetting to get back to a certain place. And unfortunately, because Master Quest is only GameCube, it's kind of slow. And the 3DS version, but that's considered a completely separate game entirely. So the beginning of the game is the same. Still, Link needs to wake up, and then early game is pretty similar. Getting the sword shield, and then we'll be heading off to the Deku Tree.
We have a $64 donation from John Barr. Happy birthday, ZFG. Donation goes to ZFG's choice.
All right, so the main movement in this game, you're going to see a lot of backwalking and side hopping. And back hopping, side hopping, and rolling. So rolling is generally good for short distances. General rule of thumb is if you can get there in four or less rolls, you want to roll. Backwalking is good for distances farther than that. And then side hopping is good for when you want to turn really quickly. And you don't want to have to turn around. And also when going up and down slopes. So this early part here, I need to collect 40 rupees to go get the Deku Shield. And then from there I can go into Deku Tree. This bridge right here, you can clip on top of it by jump slashing at a precise time. So, oh my god. So your jump, the bridge is only solid from the bottom, and so you can use your jump slash to gain a little bit of height while under it and clip on top of it to get that rupee fast.
Yeah, it's also frame perfect, so
yeah, depending on the angle.
But it has a pretty good visual cue, so even frame perfect is not really that difficult. And so if you're familiar with Ocarina of Time runs, usually going straight to the Deku Tree is really not what you want. But in Master Quest, even as weird as that might sound, but in Master Quest we actually do want to go straight to the Deku Tree to get the slingshot. It's a lot more important in Master Quest than it is in regular Ocarina of Time. Also grab a Deku Stick on the way. There's this cutscene trigger right here, and I want to try to jump slash the wall right as I enter the cutscene trigger. So when you enter that cutscene, Link tries to move to a specific point, but by jump slashing the wall right before you enter the cutscene, it delays Link's movement. So to compensate, the game makes Link run faster towards that point, to the point where he actually runs too fast and runs past it, so you get a little bit closer to the Deku Tree while in the cutscene. So here in the Deku Tree is where you're going to start seeing the differences of Master Quest. So you're going to see some enemies in spots you're not used to, and some other object placements that are a bit different. The slingshot is also in a different place. Skulltula, for example. That doesn't actually lose time, since I have to read it later anyway. For example, that Skulltula is normally not there in Ocarina of Time. And the slingshot is actually on the top floor, so I'm going to go into the top floor to go get that. So side hopping in front of that door, normally there's a Navi text trigger where she tells you how to open doors right in front of it. If you side hop in front of it and press A as soon as you touch the ground, you can skip it and open the door without talking to Navi. And then this is the room where you get the slingshot. And to get the slingshot, you need to kill all the enemies in this room. There's a bunch of Goma larvae and the eggs here. And so I'm going to kill them using Deku Nuts, because the Deku Nuts have a really huge range. And so I can kill all the eggs really quickly. And then here is the slingshot. So from here, I'm actually just going to leave the Deku Tree. I'm not going to be finishing it right now. It is a requirement of all dungeons, so I will have to come back later and beat it. But it just ends up being faster to delay it until later. Now, normally you aren't supposed to be able to do anything without beating the Deku Tree, but luckily there are several ways of escaping the forest early. And so I'm going to go to Lost Woods to get out of here. Grab a few rupees on the way for a mini game later. So in Lost Woods, there's a warp that goes to Zora's River. But you're not normally supposed to be able to enter that warp until you get the silver or gold scale. But you can get to it early with a glitch. There's this stone here. This is right above where the warp leads to. And so you can do a precise jump slash to clip inside the stone and get out to Zora's River early. So here in Zora's River, I want to go directly to Zora's Domain, and then from there go to Jabba Jabba's Belly. But I can't get past the waterfall up there. You normally need Zelda's Lullaby to get past the waterfall. But I don't have Zelda's Lullaby yet, so one alternative I have is going all the way down Zora's River and grabbing the Cuckoo at the bottom of Zora's River, bringing him all the way up and then using him to fly past the waterfall. That goes down here by these rocks.
We have a $250 donation from Greg T. There have been so many great runs this week, but I have to donate during my all-time favorite game, Ocarina of Time. I lost my mom to brain cancer back in 2009, so I'm making this donation in her memory.
So here you can just barely get behind this waterfall and just fly past and get into Zora's Domain. Now here in Zora's Domain, I want to get the silver scale to get Rudo's letter, which I can give to King Zora and move him. So it's actually possible to completely skip moving King Zora. Unfortunately, it ends up not being faster the way this route works out, kind of just because of some Master Quest differences that kind of make it a little bit slow. So I've got to play this mini game where I have to die for these rupees. These rubies are placed randomly. Hopefully I get some good luck. That looks decent.
We have a $111 donation from Emily Horn. I've been watching AGDQ since the beginning and was lucky enough to attend in person a couple years ago after my mom passed away from ovarian cancer. This marathon is near our birthdays and means the world to me. Ocarina of Time was the first speedrun I ever saw, and the whole reason I found out about SDA. So please put this donation toward the runner, ZFG's choice. Never stop, guys. We have a $50 donation from Daddy Junior. To quote the sage wisdom passed down to me by Daddy, yup, ha, z, yeah! Donation is to runner's choice.
So I'm going to get the silver scale for winning that minigame, and then I can get Rudo's letter and head off to Jabba Jabba's belly.
We have a $25 donation from Kathy207. ZFG got me into speedrunning with his Zelda runs only a few weeks ago, and now I'm obsessed. Had to donate during his Master Quest run. Good luck and save Hyrule.
So everyone's favorite cutscene is coming up soon. No.
From J. McMaster J. I had to donate while ZFG runs my favorite game of all time, giving in honor of my wife's dad, who lost his battle to cancer way too young back in 1996. Good luck to all the runners, and thanks for a great event.
All right.
23 weeps later.
So now we can finally go to Jabu. So normally you're supposed to get a fish and dump a fish right in front of Jabu so he eats it and sucks you in. But you can clip inside of Jabu on the side of his mouth by doing a jump slash against a wall. And it gives you a really high speed and just gets you straight through into the mouth.
His hitbox also extends above him, so you can jump slash on top of his mouth, too, to get in.
So Jabu is probably one of the weirdest changes in Master Quest, because there's a bunch of cows in the walls, and all of these cows act as switches, which is the reason I needed the slingshot. And so in Jabu here, there's this water jet down below that prevents you from going in this door. I'm going to get the infinite sword glitch, which is a glitch where your sword swings infinitely, which I did by doing a crouch stab and interrupting it with some action, in that case opening a chest. And that prevents you from falling, or in the case of the water jet, being pushed up by the water jet. So I got stuck inside it, and I was close enough to the door to open it. So I'm actually entering this room from behind, skipping a large section from above. Also, Deconuts are a lot more useful than a lot of casual players think, which is why I got a few extra Deconuts in the pots there. They're actually really good for just killing enemies really quickly, especially in this room. The objective in this room is to kill all the enemies, and then the boomerang chest will appear. And one really neat thing about Jabu in Master Quest is that, at least from a speedrunning standpoint, in normal Ocarina of Time, you always need to meet Rudo and take Rudo around the whole dungeon to get the boomerang. And it's really boring and tedious, and it kind of makes Jabu the worst dungeon in a regular Ocarina of Time for speedrunning. But in Master Quest, you can completely avoid Rudo completely. No cutscene, no taking her around the dungeon. So it makes the dungeon a lot more interesting to me. And then this next room, there's another really important cow switch, which contains the best item in the game, the bomb chews. And so bomb chews, the reason, it's basically bombs and bomb chews combined. The reason they're so important is explosives, bombs, and options. You can just do so many amazing tricks in this game. One which is coming up very soon. And there's just so many uses for them, and getting them early especially is just really good. So coming up next, I want to go directly to the room right before the boss room. And there's a big electric slimy thing blocking it. You're supposed to kill the tentacles to get rid of it. But I want to skip getting rid of those tentacles. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to shoot another cow switch and try to open a door at the same time. And so my door opening got interrupted by the cutscene of that chest falling. And so what happened is the game tried to load the next room, which at the same time has to unload some stuff in the current room. And one of the things it unloaded was that big slimy thing, which is what Navi's telling me about right now, which isn't there. So I can get in here early. And then for this room, there's this one puzzle where you have to shoot a cow 3 times until it raises up, and it raises into that position. But if you already know where the switch is, you can just shoot it there. You have no need to shoot the cow. And then here is the boss, Baronade.
Yeah, he also did a mega flip there with that bomb chew to flip over a large distance using the recoil from the damage.
Yeah, when you roll and you try to backflip right as you get up from your roll and your shield gets hit, it'll send you really fast when you backflip, which is really useful for crossing large gaps like that. So for Baronade, the first part you just need to hit these tentacles with a boomerang. And then after this, the Beeries are going to come out of his body, and Deku Nuts are really good for killing them quickly. And then I sort of Deku Stick Jump Slash there. When I'm doing a crouch stab like this, this is called a power crouch stab, it always has the attack power of your last attack you use. So when I use the Deku Stick Jump Slash, it stored the power of the Deku Stick Jump Slash in my crouch stab. And the Deku Stick Jump Slash actually has double the power of the Kikiri Sword Jump Slash. So it did a lot of damage to Baronade pretty quickly. And then I grabbed that one heart container. That's the only heart container, assuming everything goes well, that's the only heart container I'll be grabbing in the run. I'm pretty much forced to skip most of the other ones. And that's the end of Jabu. You can read some donations now.
All right. We have $20 from Anonymous. I have friends who are currently going through tough times due to cancer. Respect to everyone who is a part of this. Let's kill cancer and save the cows. We have a $10 donation from Spurwinnable. Second time watcher, still don't get the animals reference, but kill him anyway. We have a $10 donation from JS Penguin. My grandmother was diagnosed with renal cell cancer 1 year ago, and we lost her in May. Let's destroy it for good. I'll donate 10 more if the reader pronounces Traubel correctly. Got it. We have a $50 donation from Marumel. We've been watching the marathon all week, and we're so glad to finally have a chance to donate for AGDQ 2016. We've recently lost a close family member to bone cancer, so let's beat up cancer, beat up the cuckoos, but save the other animals.
All right, so now that I'm done with Jabu, Jabu is the only dungeon I'm actually going to complete as child. There's one other dungeon I'm going to visit as child, but I just need to grab an item from it, so I'm going to head down to Kakariko to go down there. And before I leave Zora's Domain, I need to go get a fish. So bottled items are extremely powerful in this game in terms of glitches. They can do some of the most amazing stuff ever. So I need to catch a fish here, which will be extremely useful for later on. Thank you. There's a small time saver here where I'm going to drop off this waterfall and try to jump slash it. It'll send me back really fast. And I did a little trick called a super swim there, where if you have a really high speed underwater and you hold up and mash Z, you can preserve that speed in the water. And then I'm going to do another trick here called a Hess. I'm going to try to mega flip into the water and then hold a very precise position on the control stick. I messed it up a little bit there. But what I was trying to do there is you hold a very precise position on the control stick just barely outside the dead zone, which we call the ESS zone, or extended super slide zone. And if you hold the control stick in this position, Link will kind of shuffle his feet without really moving, just turning. And when you do that, Link will preserve any speed he has. So what I was trying to do there is mega flip into the water, preserve the speed from the water, then hold the ESS position when I get back on land, and I'll have a really high speed, and I can use that to slide up all the way to Kakariko, which also would have skipped the owl. Do not grab the Koko. And so now I'm going to head to the graveyard for the next trick. What I want to do is go into the Shadow Temple as Child, which you are absolutely never supposed to do under normal circumstances, but there's some neat things you can do to get in there. So what I want to do is a glitch called a Super Slide Teleport. I'm going to try to... So what a Super Slide is you try to roll into some grabbable object while shielding and targeting, and you want to try to grab it near the end of your roll and have your shield hit. And that should send you back at a really high speed as long as you're holding your shield up. And so now when I release my shield, I'm going to get warped back because Link is going to try to pick up that piece of grass I just tried to super slide off of. And I don't have any strength upgrade right now. I don't have Goron Bracelet or Silver Gauntlets or anything like that. So I can't pick it up. So what happens is the game tries to make Link... When it does the animation for Link trying to pick it up, it warps him back, but it keeps his height value. So I gain some height while going up the slopes in the graveyard. And then in addition to that, I also have the Infinite Sword Glitch active, which, as I mentioned earlier, prevents me from falling. So when I warp back, I was just in the air. And then from there, I can slide up to the ledge and walk around to Shadow Temple. There's also normally a door in front of Shadow Temple, but I side-hopped over a loading trigger, which prevents the door from loading. And now in Shadow Temple, there's this large gap that Child Link is normally never supposed to cross, but you can cross it with a Mega Flip. And then there's another trick coming up here, where if you see over there, there's that gate. I want to clip through the wall and get past that gate. You're normally supposed to open that gate with the Truth Spinner, which is that bird statue you have to spin, and it'll randomly be one of three of the five poles that will correctly open the gate. But I can completely skip any randomness by doing this Mega Flip clip. It's a very precise Mega Flip. But if I do it right, I'll just go straight through the wall.
What he's doing now is called pause buffering.
Nice.
So some tricks are really precise. We're able to kind of buffer to the correct frames so that he can make the right inputs at the exact right moments.
So the reason I need to come down here is just to get a key. If you may remember, in normal Ocarina of Time, you don't really need to do a whole lot to get the hover boots. You just kind of enter, you go to the left, and then you go through a few doors, and you go straight to Dead Hand. But in Master Quest, you need to come down here to get this key, and then head back up to open a door that's locked. And I also need to use another Mega Flip to get back, because there's another giant gap in the way. And there's also a wall I need to blow up here. So the entire reason I want to come to Shadow Temple as Child is because of this room specifically. In this room, if you come here as adult, there's going to be a Song of Time block and an Ice Witch blocking your way to Dead Hand. The Song of Time block is right in the corridor I'm in right now. It does not load as Child. And I can use the slingshot to open that Ice Witch. If I was adult, I would need both the Song of Time and the bow to get through here. And I'm actually going to be skipping both of those things in this run because they're incredibly slow to get the way this route works out. So it saves a huge amount of time to come here and get them as Child. I'm also going to take some damage from Dead Hand for a Death Warp coming up very soon. For Dead Hand, I have to wait to attack him because he's only vulnerable right before he goes back underground. Come on. And then here I'll get the hover boots. Now, as I mentioned earlier, save warping in Master Quest is very slow. What a save warp is basically you save and reset the game, and it'll put you back in a set position. When it's in a dungeon, you always go back to the beginning of the dungeon. And I want to go back to the beginning of Shadow Temple just to leave here, because I no longer need to be here. But save warping in Master Quest, again, is extremely slow because I have to go through the game selection menu, so death warping out of here is much faster. And from here, I just need to leave Kakariko and head off to the Temple of Time. Gonna attempt another Hess here. Nice. Ah. So you don't need water specifically to do a Hess. You can also roll into an explosion and then hold the ESS position, which again is just barely outside of the dead zone on the control stick, to try to preserve that speed. Unfortunately, it's pretty difficult on the GameCube version of Ocarina of Time. On the N64 version, it's actually incredibly easy, but on the GameCube and on the Virtual Console version, it gets a lot harder because the dead zone is for some reason much bigger on these versions. And so I need to get into Market here. And the bridge is going up, but I can get on these chains before the bridge actually registers as being up. So what happened there is, if the last time you looked at the bridge, it was down, and you get close to the bridge without completely looking at it, the chains will still be there, and you can get onto the chains. And then as soon as you let the camera back up a bit and fully load the bridge, you'll warp directly up to where it is. And now, I need to buy the Hylian Shield, which is the reason I was getting some rupees earlier. I'll need this first thing as adult. And so, because I got in here at night, I had to sneak in by jumping over the door. Now I'm going to head off to Temple of Time. So, normally, you are never supposed to be able to do anything interesting in Temple of Time unless you've beaten all three of the Child Dungeons and have the Song of Time. I have one Child Dungeon beaten. And so the Door of Time is blocking the Master Sword, but there's a small crack between the door and the wall, which you can use to get out of bounds and get to the Master Sword early. There we go. Yes. And so, I have only beaten one of the Child Dungeons so far. The other two, Dodongo's Cavern and Deku Tree, I will beat. They are requirements of the category. I'll just be doing them as adult instead. Doing them as adult just is so much faster because Adult Link can just do maneuvers that Child Link can't and just move faster in general. Plus, Adult Link can also take advantage of a glitch called Wrong Warping, which will be coming up in about half an hour. It's one of the most important tricks in the game. You can probably read some donations now.
All right, we have a $150 donation from Windmill Guy. Go around and around and around. What fun, I'm so happy. I'm a music man who loves to go around and around, go around and around. We have a $50 donation from Anonymous. I want to hear how the speaker says fast taco. There you go. We have $50 from CC Plays Games. Having just defeated thyroid cancer this year, I absolutely had to donate. I'm so proud to be a part of this incredible community of gamers who have come together to help people just like me. The love and support I've received is indescribable, and this was the perfect opportunity to pay it forward. $25 goes to the Mario Kart 64 two-player, one controller, and the other $25 goes to saving those frames. Much love, CC. We have a $50 donation from Lucas K. Hey, ZFG, good luck on the run. Make sure to get everyone hyped for the Deku Tree Warp. Shoutouts to Renee and Theo. Hope you enjoy the run. We have a $50 donation from Dins. Thank you for all the hard work, especially all those behind the scenes. I love hearing how all the different ways that games can be exploited. Keep up the good work. Zelda 64 block hype! We have a $50 donation from Up Too Late Gaming. Donating during LOZ-OOT because it's great. And I figured I should donate at some point, so save the sages and kill the animals. We have a $10 donation from Eric Einarsson. Greetings from Sweden. It's 3:30 a.m. here and I'm up watching King Zora scoot over in a speedrun. What is this madness? Keep on being awesome and put this towards killing those animals. Hype!
Unfortunately, this cutscene is quite a bit long, but after this, there's actually very few cutscenes in the rest of the run. Basically, every other major cutscene left in the run, I can completely skip. So it will speed up quite a bit after this. So to get out of the Temple of Time, the door is actually solid on both sides, so I can't just walk out. I will have to save warp here. And this will take me back to the beginning of the Temple of Time. Unfortunately, death warping is pretty slow there. There actually is a way to get out of bounds and use the hover boots to get back across the Door of Time, but it's kind of precise and it only saves like a second at best. And so whenever you save warp, if you save warp in the overworld, it'll always put you at the Temple of Time as adult. As child, it'll always put you back in Link's house. And then if you're in any dungeon, it'll always put you back at the beginning of that dungeon. And so, on my C-buttons right now, you might notice there's bombs there, and I didn't actually get bombs. That's just something that always happens whenever you become adult. The game will auto-equip bombs to C down. It does the same thing for Deku Nuts and Ocarina, except if you don't have those items, then it won't equip them. Which doesn't really quite make sense, because normally you can't skip the Ocarina. And you can't skip bombs either, but only bombs is auto-equipped. Trying to do a Hess there to save a little bit of time. So the first thing I want to do as adult here is go over to this river and do a glitch called Reverse Bottle Adventure, which is I'm going to get a bottle on my B button, and then based on the item I have on C right, I can modify parts of my inventory with that B bottle. Now to get a bottle on my B button, I'm going to put a bottle in Link's hand and try to take out my sword right as I hit the water here. And now, by holding Z and R, and holding the bottle button, and letting go of shield to swing it, the game still registers my B button as the last button I pressed. And when you swing a bottle, it always goes over the last button you press. That's just how like catching something in a bottle works. And so, because B button was the last button I pressed, it put a bottle on my B button. And now, the first thing I did bottle adventure with was an empty bottle. So by catching a fish with empty bottle on C right, that'll give me a bottle in my third bottle slot. By dumping that fish with Poe on C right, Poe modifies my bomb chew count, which is why I suddenly had 20 bomb chews, now 19. And now I'm going to catch bugs in my bottle on B, and this is going to give me 29 bomb chews. Empty bottle being the value of 20, and bugs being the value of 29, which corresponds to the bomb chew count I just got. So that's all the reverse bottle adventure that will be done in this run. Reverse bottle adventure actually has a lot of other interesting uses, especially with the trade items in the adult trade quest, such as Poacher Saw and Broken Goron Sword and Kojiro. They can give you stuff like bomb bags, songs, medallions, quivers, heart pieces. And so here's the Dampay race. I need to race Dampay to get the hookshot. He'll throw a bunch of random fire everywhere. Hopefully not a whole lot of them hit me. Each flame I hit costs roughly 2 seconds. A good time for this race is 47, although I got hit. 47 is like the average good. 46 is the best you can do. I already got hit once by a flame, so I can't get 47 anymore, but it should be like a, still should be good. And so now he'll give me the hookshot. Now to get out of Dampay's grave, I need to go through that door there. And past that door, there are two Song of Time blocks. And again, I don't have Song of Time right now, so I can't get rid of them by playing Song of Time. But what I can do instead is use a bomb chew to clip through the wall and get past them. So I'm going to run a bomb chew here. A little bit late there. And this bomb chew is going to boost me through the wall there. And then I can exit through the window here. So you can use the hookshot to hookshot onto roofs and do some slightly faster movement through Kakariko. Then I'm going to head up to Death Mountain and go to Dzongo's Cavern. I'm going to try to do another Hess here off this sign right next to me. So for the changes in Dodongo's Cavern, it actually has some pretty neat changes, specifically for speedrunning. The bomb chest, instead of being all the way at the top floor, is actually on the bottom floor. Now, in normal gameplay, being at the bottom floor actually makes it longer to get, but because I'm adult, I can just climb up a small ledge and just really easily grab it. But before I grab it, I want to light the eyes for the big Dodongo head with bomb chews. So if you stand in a really specific place, you can let bomb chews run on the walls, and they'll hit the eyes. And so you can hit light the eyes from below. Normally you're supposed to climb to the top and hit them from above, and that saves a lot of time. And then from here I can climb right up here and grab the bomb chest. And now Dodongo's Cavern is going to be another dungeon where I'm just going to enter now and leave and come back later. I just want to have my bombs. So now I'm going to head up to Goron City and get a few items in the Goron City and Lost Woods area. So in Goron City, there's this rolling Goron that you need to stop by blowing him up. And then when you talk to him, he'll give you the Goron Tunic. So normally you need the Goron Tunic for the Fire Temple. I won't specifically be needing it to like not die in the Fire Temple. There's actually one trick that I simply can't do without the Goron Tunic, because I'll need to be standing in lava while doing a trick. This is probably a good time for donations.
We have a $25 donation from Synogen. Donation towards Prevent Cancer Foundation. Watched a couple of previous AGDQs. First time donating. Friend of mine just finished a third round, so here's to trying to kick cancer where it hurts. Go, Daddy. Go, ZFG. Hello, donation reader. Winky face. We have a $50 donation from Kiosk. AGDQ hype! Shout out to everyone involved with putting on this great event. Odds are everyone knows or will know somebody that cancer has affected. Every dollar has the potential to help. I hope these dollars help. Kill the animals. ZFG, thanks for the amazing display of game-breaking destruction. I always appreciate seeing you run. To all other runners, thanks for destroying my childhood memories in the most awesome way possible.
So now I'm going to head out to Deathman Crater. If you let go of this statue at the exact time it starts moving backwards, you can save a little bit of time by not having to go through the whole animation, but I missed it there. It's pretty precise. Now here, I want to get the Bolero of Fire song, which is... the cutscene trigger is right on this bridge in front of me. I want to get the song, but I don't want to watch the cutscene, so I'm going to try to do a glitch to fall out of bounds. Alright, so what I tried to do there is I grabbed the ledge right as the cutscene started, and this causes Link to do this weird glitch where he kind of falls through the ground. And when you trigger that cutscene, you get the song immediately. So by voiding out in the middle of the cutscene, I get the song and don't have to watch the whole cutscene. I want to be sure not to take damage here, just because I gotta manage my health for a certain trick coming up. So I want to go to Sacred Forest Meadow right now, and Mido is here blocking the path, but I can do a mega flip to get over him, because he's really short. You can also just do a normal backflip, but it's a little bit slower. So in Sacred Forest Meadow, there's this big maze you have to go through, but you can skip it with this glitch called Ground Jump. By trying to grab a bomb right as you're targeting and shielding, after the bomb explodes, you won't be able to use any of your items. But if you try to backflip or side hop, you'll get a forward jump, which I used there to grab the ledge here. And now I'm doing a glitch where the game kind of thinks I'm on a ladder right now. I got onto a ladder and immediately hit off. And in this state, I can walk up slippery slopes, such as this slope right here, where I can get out of bounds, and now I'm going to side hop out of bounds. And now I'm going to fall into the cutscene trigger of the Minuet of Forest, and similar to the Blur of Fire cutscene, I will get the song, completely skip the cutscene. And now I have to do it again and go up to Forest Temple. Also, the music is all stopped because it stopped during the cutscene, and then because the cutscene kind of automatically got disabled by voiding out, it still has that silent music, or no music. So in Forest Temple Master Quest, they kind of just added a lot of Skulltulas to these first two rooms. So I can use a Deccanut there just to make sure that Skulltula doesn't annoy me, and grab this key. Same for the upcoming room. The only difference in this room is they changed one Skulltula to three Skulltulas. So now in this room, there's going to be a cutscene where all the Poes come out of these flames, and they try to push the elevator down. So there is a way to skip this cutscene, but generally it's only useful if you actually want to take the elevator down early. Skipping it for just, like, to skip it purposes, it's not really faster at all. If you do it perfectly, you might save 1 second. And so, at the top of these stairs, I can get over these rails right here and clip through the floor by doing a backflip and stopping my momentum by pulling out the hookshot. And by jumping straight out here, I can jump straight into the loading zone for the boss and skip all of Horus Temple. So the way that works is, whenever you're in any dungeon, all of the loading zones and all of the collision, that's the floors, ceilings, and walls, are all loaded in every room in the dungeon. So if I know where the loading zone is, I just have to somehow get out of bounds and touch that loading zone. So right there, I just clipped through the floor, jumped forward, and hit the loading zone, because it is right below that room. Now for the Phantom Ganon fight, he'll try to split into two, a fake one and a real one. The real one is the one that's brighter. Now I'm going to try to kill Phantom Ganon quickly with the infinite sword glitch. It's not only useful for not falling, but also for dealing damage really quickly. So the reason I turned around and used my hookshot there is when you try to shoot Phantom Ganon with the hookshot or the bow, he'll try to spin his staff to try to block him, but he's actually vulnerable during that time. So by shooting the hookshot in the other direction, it made him spin his staff, made him vulnerable, and my ISG actually hit him again to stun him again and make him get hit again. Because Phantom Ganon actually cannot get stun-locked, like, just by hitting him repeatedly at the right times. He actually will always get up at some point, but you can use that to hit him as soon as he gets up. And now here I'm going to do a cutscene skip. I need to step in the blue light to get the medallion, but I don't want to watch the cutscene. So what I'm going to do is a glitch called Ocarina Items by catching something in my bottle, and then doing a backflip, pressing the bottle button, and then pressing another item Link holds in his hands. He can play it as a fake ocarina. So right now I'm playing my sword as an ocarina right now. And I'm going to use this to gain control while the blue warp is going, and I want to die on a very specific frame. This frame. And so by dying at the right time, the game is going to give me the medallion, and I won't have to watch the cutscene. Then it'll be noted by a white flash. So now I'm going to head to Kakiri Forest and go back to the Deku Tree finally. So the Deku Tree normally you are never supposed to enter as adult, but the thing that's blocking entering the Deku Tree as adult is actually the Deku Tree's mouth, which is always there as adult. But what you can do is, if the mouth doesn't load, then you have free access into the Deku Tree. So to make it not load, I have to bypass a load trigger. So Kakiri Forest is split up into two different sections, the area with the houses and the area with the Deku Tree. And then there's a loading trigger in the middle of that. So to skip this loading trigger, I'm going to get on that ledge over there by doing a super slide and equipping hover boots. And now that I'm on top of this ledge, I can skip going through that little tunnel there, which will skip the loading trigger. And now you'll see there's basically nothing loaded here. The collision is, again, still loaded. I can walk here, but the Deku Tree's mouth is not there. You'll see Link kind of fall right here. So that's where the mouth is supposed to be. So I can walk into the Deku Tree. So I'll need a safety save there just for an important trick coming up that could go very badly, but hopefully it doesn't. So I'm going to head back to the slingshot room where I first got the slingshot. There's nothing to get there again here, but there's an interesting thing that Adult Link can do. Adult Link can actually do a lot of interesting things in the Child Dungeon just because of his height. So I'm going to soar a ground jump to get to the top of this platform here. And when this platform sinks down, Link is also going to clip through the floor with it. And then I can jump slash off that platform. And it'll send me backwards really fast, and I'll hit a loading trigger to go into Goma's room. Goma fight's pretty easy. You just throw Deku Nuts, crouch stab, and then it's over. And so coming up is basically the most important trick in the run. So this is going to be a wrong warp. What I'm going to do is, just like in Forest Temple, I'm going to do Ocarina items on the edge of the blue warp to gain control. This time, instead of dying, I want to fall out of bounds. And to get out of bounds, I need to get to the top of the door that just closed at the beginning of Goma's room. And so I'm going to need to do this sort of complicated setup. So basically, once you start the blue warp, a timer starts. And once the timer reaches a certain number, it'll begin the cutscene. What I want to do is have that timer try to begin the cutscene as soon as I void out. And if that happens correctly, I will enter an interesting place.
Now, normally, what ZFG would do is, you used to have to use an item timer from a trade sequence to get out of this room, but he's going to do a trick called bomb hovering using the infinite sword glitch, which he just activated right there. And what it does is the infinite sword glitch allows you to not fall off ledges because the game thinks you're constantly slashing. So he can backflip onto explosion and shield the damage, and because he can't fall, he'll just keep gaining height. And he's going to use this in conjunction with a glitch called action swap to get past this door.
So coming up, he needs to get on top of this door. The door is clipped into the ceiling, so he's going to need a ground jump to reach it. So he'll do a trick called action swap, which he'll throw some bomb chews, and then he'll pull a bomb chew when the second bomb chew explodes to cancel the bomb chew from actually getting thrown out, and he'll store it. So then he'll pull out his hook shot and then cancel his hook shot with the bomb chew, which will let him ground jump.
So from here, I just need to get into a specific position and then do one side hop hover to get over an out of bounds area. And then once I'm over the out of bounds area, I'm going to wait for a little bit and to wait for the camera to lock. So once you're in an out of bounds area for roughly 10 seconds, the camera's just going to lock in place instead of being right behind Link, and it'll follow Link instead. And so I'm going to use this to manipulate the camera to try to load the blue warp again right at the right time that I fall out of bounds. And now I'm at Bongo Bongo.
Awesome.
And it's also important to note that whenever I do a wrong warp like this, it does also give me the spiritual stone.
Yeah, what makes that trick the hardest in the run is just the fact that it's a bunch of different glitches all put into one in order to get the wrong warp to work properly.
So I'm going to use the infinite sword glitch again to beat Bongo really fast. You can actually stun lock Bongo Bongo. You don't need the infinite sword glitch, but it does help quite a bit. So as soon as he tries to hit me, he'll get hit by my infinite sword glitch and then just die. And so after this death cutscene, I'm going to do another cutscene skip similar to what I did in Forest Temple, where I need to die on a specific frame. So you'll see a little weird thing here, where I'm going to start walking off the platform, and then Link is going to kind of start floating. So you still keep these properties of the blue warps while you have control while they're going, which includes that kind of floaty property, because when you enter it normally, Link kind of floats up and starts spinning, which is also why you start spinning here. And so again, by dying at the right time, I will skip the cutscene and get the medallion, and I'll be back to the Deku Tree, because that was what the game thinks is the last dungeon I entered. So before I go anywhere else again, I need to get some bombs. I have zero right now. I need a lot more than that, because they are extremely important. So there's this grass patch over here I'm going to try to get bombs from. This is all up to luck, how fast I get them. It shouldn't take very long, but that's not a good start. I need two bone drops, so... Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
So I'm going to head back to Lost Woods. I'm going to use that warp I used earlier in the run to go to Zora's River, and then from there head to Zora's Domain, and then from there go to Lake Hylia and go to the Water Temple. You can also clip into this stone as adult. I actually don't need to clip into it. I have the silver scale, but I kind of just like doing this anyway. They're like the same speed. And I get past the waterfall this time, I can just use hover boots. Because again, I still don't have Zelda's Lullaby, and I won't be getting in the run. In fact, that's what makes the wrong warp to Bongo Bongo so important, is that it completely skips Zelda's Lullaby. So here in Zora's Domain, I want to take the warp to Lake Hylia. You're normally not supposed to be able to do it because Zora's Domain is frozen, but you can get out of bounds with that ladder by trying to climb a ladder right on the side, like where the ladder meets the ledge. You'll clip through the wall, so I can get out of bounds this way and get into the loading trigger for Lake Hylia. Now for Lake Hylia, I also need to get out of bounds here by doing a ledge clip there. So what that was is I tried to roll and grab a ledge, and if as soon as you grab the ledge, you target the wall next to you, Link will turn to face that wall, and because of just the way Link grabs the ledge, he'll clip into the floor, and then you can just drop down, fall out of bounds. And so luckily this water in Lake Hylia extends very far out of bounds, so I can just swim around it and swim around into Water Temple without the need for iron boots. Now for the first room of Water Temple, there's a big gap that normally would prevent you from getting to the room right before the boss room until you get the long shot, but by doing a super slide I can get past that. And then in the room after that comes the best trick in Master Quest. So in this room, they added really fast floor raisers. They're usually a lot slower to try to force you to use long shot to get up here by hitting that switch. This switch activates some hookshot platforms you would hookshot up to. Instead, I'm just going to grab onto these hookshot platforms. I'm going to do a slide hop and a jump slash, and then the door. That trick is exactly as easy as it looks. For some reason, if you just jump slash at a certain height on some walls, including that door, you just clip right through it. And they were generous enough to put a hookshot platform at the right height right there. Now for the Morpha fight, again, I'm going to have to die after this fight, so I'm going to be taking damage while waiting for a Morpha to create the tentacle. And then once Morpha's made the tentacle, I'm going to lure Morpha into the corner and just kind of trap it and kill it there. Hello? 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 Okay. Am I gonna get hit?
Oh.
Well. Oh. I guess that's mine. That's never happened before.
At least we get to see this awesome trick again.
Yes.
Kind of worried about my bomb count now. So again, after this, I'm just going to do another cutscene skip by dying on the right frame.
We have a $140 donation from Regular Guy. One of my goals this year is to donate $600 to charity, and this donation is a great way to begin meeting that goal. I hope I can inspire others to set themselves a similar goal. Besides, the best part of GDQ marathons is donating. If you don't believe me, try it for yourself.
I dropped my fish right as I got hit there to take two hits from that bomb. When you take a hit from a bomb, you have invincibility frames. But by dumping that fish there, it wasted some invincibility frames, allowing me to take two hits, which just allows me to take damage faster. Alright, and that's Water Temple. So now to get out of here, I want to play the Bolero of Fire. because it's the best warp song to go to my next place, but I don't have any Ocarina right now, so I actually need to use Ocarina items again to play a warp song. And then from here, I'm going to head to Zongo's Cavern.
We have a $20 donation from Jagger Savage. I've been waiting for this run all week. ZFG is the reason I got into speedrunning. Is there nothing he can't clip through? Here's some money for a great cause. We have a $25 donation from Spencer254. I've watched runs from the past 3 years and love all the work you do. So happy to finally catch one live. I'm always bragging about this event and the amount of money it raises to friends. Keep up the great work. Donation goes to Runner's Choice.
So I need a save warp there because I'm going to be doing another wrong warp coming up. And wrong warps are partially dependent on the last cutscene you watched. And if the last cutscene I watched was the Bolero Fire cutscene, which it was, then the wrong warp would actually crash. But if the title screen is my last cutscene, then it will not crash. So I just have to save warp there to make the title screen my last cutscene. So now because I lit the eyes for the Dodongo head earlier in the run, I can just walk right in here. And then also to skip going around a few rooms, I can climb this ledge because Adult Link is really tall. I'm also going to try to get a bomb drop from one of these guys because my bombs are really low. Please tell me I dropped a bomb. Oh, that's actually not what I wanted. I gotta save warp again. But it'll allow me to get another bomb drop.
We have a $50 donation from Flan Flan. Hello, AGDQ. Salutations from Australia. AGDQ and SGDQ bring out the goodness in everyone. So many people cooperating for the good of stopping cancer, but also simply cooperating, period, in an effort to be excellent games in new, fast, and ridiculous ways. There's nothing more wonderful to see than team effort. Everyone, take a moment to pat yourselves on the back for doing such an awesome thing.
And here is the easiest boss in the game. There is, like, nothing you can do to screw this fight up. I like to throw the bombs off the wall into his mouth because it looks cool. It's like the only thing you can do in this fight to, wow, make it interesting. Alright, so coming up after this is another wrong warp. Again, I'm going to die. This time I'm going to die right after I cancel the Ocarina items on the blue warp. And then it should take me to another interesting place. Setting up these Ocarina items is pretty precise. It needs to be directly on the edge of the blue warp.
Really?
Wait, I might be able to save this. This will be kind of risky, but I'm not going to go for it, no. That would have been right. The reason we use fish for these is because normally you can re-catch a fish without moving. Normally. But sometimes it'll jump away. Alright, now as soon as I cancel the Ocarina, I will die. And now the game's gonna try to load the beginning of Dodongo's Cavern at the same time it tries to load the Goron Ruby cutscene. And when that happens, it'll instead throw me into Gerudo Training Grounds. Now, as soon as I leave Gerudo Training Grounds, because there's a Gerudo guard right there, I'll instantly get caught and thrown in jail. But this is actually pretty good because it gets me in a good position to get to the Haunted Wasteland quickly. So normally to get to the Haunted Wasteland, you need to save all the carpenters and have the Gerudos open the gate for you. But you can skip past the gate by going out of bounds. Right there, you can actually clip through the ceiling there with a precise hookshot. And now from here, I'm going to get on this railing, and from here I can get onto this mountainside where I can just walk past the gate and head off to the Haunted Wasteland. And now in the Haunted Wasteland, what I want to try to do is do a Hess through the entire thing, but it is pretty difficult because you're going backwards so fast. So for the first part of the Wasteland, you really just need to follow the flags. For the second part, you're normally supposed to use the Lens of Truth to follow a Poe, but if you know the direction, you don't need to follow the Poe. Wait. There's a lot of good visual cues on the ground to indicate where you're going. So it's actually not too difficult to get through here without Poe. Now I'm going to super slide over to Spirit Temple, but I'm not going to enter Spirit Temple immediately. What I instead want to do is try to use bomb hovering to get to the top of Spirit Temple and get the mirror shield early. So because with bomb hovering you're able to just gain a lot of height really easily, I can use it to get all the way to the top of Spirit and get the mirror shield early because the mirror shield is outside on one of the hands. First, I need to find this Gwei and make sure he doesn't interrupt my hover. In fact, I want to use him to start the hover. Now, when I backflip here, I'm going to land on this seam here, and I need to get up here, precisely walk up this line, and then hookshot up to the Silver Gauntlet's chest. Now, Silver Gauntlet's is not what I want, but from here I can do a super slide onto the other hand of the Spirit Temple, where the Mirror Shield is. And he's in the Shield. Now, I can't enter Spirit Temple from the upper side here because everywhere I want to go requires a key, so I need to just jump down here and go in Spirit Temple from below. So in Spirit Temple and Master Quest, there's a few neat chests in the first room. There's two bomb shoe chests that I really want to get because I have a lot more bomb shoes I need to use in the rest of the run. And then after that, I'm going to try to get to the child side of the Spirit Temple. So Spirit Temple is split into two sections, the adult side and the child side. And there's a lot of areas in both sides that only child or only adult is supposed to get into. So I'm going to get into the child side, which adulting should never get into, by doing a super slide clip through a wall. And I'm going to hit that loading trigger through that crawl space and load this room. I need to kill these torch slugs to open this door here. This is where I really want to go. So in this room here, there's this metal gate, and if you climb on it as Adult Link, you will clip through the ceiling. Actually, I'm going to safety save just in case. So you just climb up here as Adult, clip through the ceiling. If you backflip from there, you will end up on a higher ground. So where I am right now is actually the main room of Spirit Temple. This is where the big statue is. So now what I'm gonna try to navigate through this room blindly using some simple movement and get into a very specific spot. This is right under the statue's arm. And now I'm gonna start hovering. I'm gonna try to get out of bounds. The statue's arm is made in a specific way where if you get under it in a specific way, it'll clip you out of bounds. I need to really? If this hits me. Okay. Alright, so I'm out of bounds, and from here I can hover directly into the boss door. Alright. So you might have noticed that the bomb chew hovers look kind of weird once I was out of bounds. So when you try to shield drop a bomb chew out of bounds on the GameCube version, it'll do a double explosion, which is really nice for hovering out of bounds because a lot of times if you try to just backflip and then shield drop a bomb chew, it won't hit your shield because you backflip too far. But that's not the case on GameCube because of the double explosion, which is really good for hovering out of bounds. On N64, the game actually will completely crash if you try to shield drop a bomb chew out of bounds. So for this Iron Knuckle fight, I'm going to store a jump slash in my power crouch stab and then just run right up to him. And if you're really close, he just can't hit you. And I want him to get him down to really low health, but not kill him immediately, and then lure him over this corner. And I want to use him to clip out of bounds. So if you try to hookshot something right next to a wall, it'll clip you forward out of bounds. and you can use the Iron Knuckles armor to clip out of bounds there. And then I use a bomb shoe to kill him, which completely skips the cutscene. And then I can go fight Twin Rova. You can probably read a donation or two right now.
We have a $1,000 donation from somethingartistic.net. Hey guys, Something Artistic here. We both spent so much time playing the Legend of Zelda series that it only makes sense to donate now. Super excited to watch the rest of ZFG's run and then the Majora's Mask run while making Majora's Mask stickers. We simply must see the Excalibur route for Final Fantasy, so put this towards that. We have a $10.24 donation from Legend of Link. Looks like Morpho was practicing for AGDQ too.
So I'm gonna use a hookshot to try to stun one of them while the other is shooting, just to make it easier to shoot them. Sometimes they can just fly around the room and get to completely awful positions. And that just helps a lot. And then after four hits, she'll go into her second phase.
Usually.
And so this time, she's going to shoot fire or ice beams, and you're supposed to absorb three hits of each. So a lot of people think that it's random how many she shoots of each in a row. It's actually only random once she gets to low health. When she's at full health like this, it'll always be three in a row. And I'm also using the hookshot there to make her spin, which makes her move to the next platform faster. It takes about 3 seconds each time. And then with careful crouch stab timing, you can just kill Twin Rova in one cycle. And then after this is going to be one last standard cutscene skip, just dying on the right frame to skip the cutscene.
We have a $500 donation from Sprite. Tell me a Zelda joke. Well, in comes Breath Elderwood here with $25. He's been watching since 2011 and donating ever since. You guys rock. Incoming unintentional stealth pun. What item do Ocarina of Time speedrunners most rely on? Bugs. Proceed to groan. Another $25 inbound if my donation gets read. We have a $50 donation from Anthony Falleroni. I've been watching AGDQ videos for a few years, and this is the first time I get to watch it live, and I had to donate during my favorite game and the greatest game ever made. Let's infinite sword glitch cancer.
So when I'm doing these setups, you see me doing some very specific and sometimes kind of odd movement. So Ocarina of Time mechanics are really neat in that you have a lot of different movement options to both move in very specific amounts and to change your direction in very specific ways. So being able to both influence your direction and your angle, or your direction and your position so precisely makes a lot of these tricks that would otherwise be incredibly difficult make them actually really easy. So like a lot of people like to call them voodoo dances when I do these cutscene skips. has, it seems like they're just kind of random movements, but all these movements allow you to move so precisely to make what in other games would be like incredibly difficult tricks, like actually pretty simple. Now I'm going to head off to the final dungeon, the Fire Temple. So Fire Temple is neat in Master Quest because it kind of completely changes the general objective of Fire Temple. So in normal Ocarina of Time, the basic objective of Fire Temple is to climb to the top of Fire Temple to grab the hammer. And then once you're at the top and you have the hammer, you can do some stuff in the lower area of Fire Temple to get to the boss. Instead, in Master Quest, the hammer is all the way at the bottom of the dungeon, and you use the hammer to climb up. And the fact that the hammer is so early on is really neat, because I can get the hammer really early and then skip to the boss really quickly, too. Now, to get to the hammer quickly, you need to use this like to clip out of bounds. And I'm landing in the room right next to me. And then from here, I can super slide past the gates there. And so I'm getting into this room from behind. You normally need to get a key from another room and get in here through the other door on the bottom. But by going out of bounds there, I was able to stand in... I'm able to stand in the room Darunia is normally in, where he talks to you about the Gorons. Except with nothing loaded in there. But I'm in this one specific section where there's no wall on the other side. So I can still have access to Out of Bounds, and I can use that to get past those two gates and get to this room from behind. Here's the hammer, and I need to get a few bomb drops from the room next to me. Then I'm going to intentionally die to get back to the beginning of Fire Temple. Oh no. So now that I have the hammer, I just need to go beat the boss. And obviously I don't have the boss key, but I don't think you've seen a boss key yet anyway. So to get to the boss room, I'm going to get to this ledge here and do a ledge clip to get out of bounds. Jump forward, and I'll be in this out of bounds room again. Again, this is the room with where Darunia would talk to you. And so I kind of have to navigate around blindly, but with some simple movements I can get around pretty easily. Right now I'm on the platform right in front of the boss door, and I need to clip under it with another ledge clip. And then from here, I need to do another hover. And the boss door is right above me. And now here's Lavagia. So the way Lavagia works is there's two hitboxes. There's a hitbox for the Lavagia that pops out of the holes and a hitbox for the one that goes flying. And the hitbox for the one that goes flying goes under the last hole that it flew into. So in this opening cutscene, Lavagia is going to fly around and fly directly into the hole in front of Link. And I can use that to my advantage by dropping a bunch of bomb chews right on that hole, which will actually damage Volvagia, even while Volvagia is still kind of going in and out of the holes. And I use that to do a huge amount of damage really quickly. And to blow the bomb chews up quickly, I'm going to use Deku Nuts. And now after this comes the final wrong warp of the run. This time, I'm going to try to exit the boss door. So normally, you can't exit the boss door in Bovagia's room, but there is still a loading zone behind there. I'm just going to have to get to that loading zone out of bounds. And I'm going to try to hit that loading zone right as the blue warp tries to start the next cutscene. And this wrong warp will also abuse the floaty properties of the blue warp again, which I can use to get a pretty big jump that'll get me up to the boss door. And now I'm in Ganon's castle. So when the game tries to load, going back into Fire Temple, at the same time it tries to load the Fire Medallion cutscene, it just happens to bring you here. And now I need to die here because I'm going to do another trick coming up after this called Void Warp. And this trick is partially dependent on the coordinates you enter this map from. So I could have exited the door behind me, and that would have triggered this cutscene as well. But if I enter through that door, I'm going to have these coordinates that make the next trick incredibly difficult. And by dying, I actually get the coordinates of loading at the top of the tower, which makes the warp very easy. You can probably squeeze in a donation here.
We have a $300 donation from Anonymous. Awesome run so far, ZFG. Played this game nonstop as a kid. Brings back so many painful memories trying to beat this game as an 8-year-old boy. Good luck on the rest of your run. Let's kill those animals, guys.
All right, so here's Void Warp coming up. I'm going to try to grab an edge right next to a railing, and it's going to push me slightly out of bounds. And I'm going to use a bomb to boost me out of bounds.
Really?
Oh, I didn't...
Three slashes.
Yeah, I don't know how I forgot that. And so this bomb is going to boost me in a direction so that I void out because I fall too far at the same time I enter this loading zone. And it's going to load a room very far below and at the same time try to load my coordinates at the top of the tower. And so because I'm so high up, I can jump slash directly into this room here, and I can hit this loading zone, and this is the end of the castle escape. The double kiss. So that super slide there actually saves 1 second, and the only reason it saves time is because once Zelda opens the first set of bars, Link will move into the next room, and by loading the next room, it actually moves Zelda forward.
We have a $12 donation from Happy 12th Birthday ZFG. Just want to wish you a happy birthday. $1 for every year you have been alive. And we have a $25 donation from Softfolder. ZFG is such an amazing runner, especially for only being 12. Great job, ZFG, and everyone else running this year. I only wish I had time to watch everyone.
Thank you. Alright, so the Ganon fight's about to start. Before I start the fight, I want to store jump slash as my power crouch step, and then do a super slide into the cutscene. And the reason I want to do a super slide is if I keep my shield up during this entire cutscene, which you can only do while super sliding into it, it'll prevent Ganon from actually knocking the sword out of your hands, because I guess it's tied to the animation. And the reason this is important is the way the first phase of Ganon works is all of your weapons are reduced to doing only one damage. The exception is Deku Sticks and Master Sword, because the game thinks that you're not supposed to use them ever on Ganon's first phase. And so, because the Master Sword isn't reduced in power, it means I can hit Ganon, get Ganon's first phase down really quickly. It's normally supposed to take 10 hits from any other weapon, but with the Master Sword I can do it in 3. And then the second phase again is just more jump slashes. All right, time is coming up. Time. So what was the time on that? All right. Considering Morpha wasn't too bad. All right, so the glitch exhibition was met, correct? I'll need to switch to another version to do the glitch exhibition. Okay. And the glitch exhibition was met? Glitch exhibition was met? Okay. And I'll need to switch to another version of the game for this. Oops. Alright, so there's a lot of glitches in Ocarina of Time that aren't really used in speedruns, but are still pretty amazing. Excuse me? Yeah. Alright, so here are a few really neat glitches that you'll never see in a speedrun. So the first one is Action Swap. Now, if you remember earlier in the run, I used Action Swap during the wrong warp from Dekatree to Bongo Bongo to get a ground jump. Now, the kind of result you get from Action Swap is different depending on what items you use. So here I have Slingshot in my hand, and I'm going to try to take out my sword right as I hit the water. And now when I try to use my sword again, this happens, and it'll play the Haunted Wasteland sound. And now there's some other weird effects I can do with my Deku Stick. Oops. So now I tried to pull out the Deku Stick right before I entered the water. Now it looks normal now. Now I'm going to light it, and something weird happened, and it got really long. It can reach all the way across the room, behind me. And yeah, you can just see how long it is, going all the way over there. And I'll try to get ISG with this too. So the ISG is... Wait. ISG is pretty big as well. Alright. Next trick. So this next trick is also going to be in the Deca Tree, but as adult this time. So one neat thing about going to the Deca Tree as adult is that you can use the hammer. And one neat thing about the hammer is that when you use it in a room with Deku Scrubs, the Deku Scrubs will all pop out of their holes immediately. And so there's these three scrubs here. You can use the hammer, they'll pop out, but they'll immediately go back in. But if you use some clever camera manipulation, you can get all of them to get out of their holes. Now, only one of them is programmed with actual text. And so when you talk to these guys, they say something interesting. Yeah, so this is Navi the fairy. He's going to be my partner from now on. Yeah, so since they're not programmed with any kind of actual text, I guess they get the default text. All right, so next trick in Forest Temple. I'm going to try to open this door, but interrupt it by trying to use Din's fire. And getting hit right at the same time. So if you quick spin and use Din's fire immediately, you'll be able to do certain actions while using Din's fire, like pausing and getting hit. Oops, a little bit late there. So what I want to do is try to open this door as soon as I get hit while in the Din's fire animation. And it's going to get interrupted, and I'm going to try to open the door, and I'll be interrupted by getting hit. And this will load the next room, but keep this room loaded. Now, an important thing to note is that under the water here, there is an open chest. That chest will do some funny stuff. So I'm going to go over here and enter the water at a very specific location. And the chest will start flying. And it'll go really, really high. It's going up really fast. And it sort of will stop eventually. I'll use Din's fire here. You can see like how high it's moving up based on how far the camera is going. So this will keep moving up for quite a while, about a minute and a half, until it reaches what I guess is the game's max height limit. And then once I get to that max height limit, another interesting thing is going to happen. So I'm just going to sit here for a little bit. You can see how low the hookshot is going there. Yeah, so once you get really high up, this starts happening. All right, well, that's interesting, but now I'm going to jump off. Maybe I'll land somewhere interesting. Oh, no, I think I missed it. Wait. I don't know. Okay, yeah, I missed it. I'll actually just say warp out of here, because this will take a long time to fall. But what I was trying to do there is I can actually hit the loading zone to exit Forest Temple there, but it's actually pretty precise because I'm so high up, and a tiny angle change will mess everything up. So one last glitch to show off outside of Forest Temple. So Sacred Forest Meadow is full of a bunch of moblins, and the moblins can do some interesting stuff. What I'm going to try to do is push one of them into the water. And really? I'm bad. Alright, he's going over there. I need to wait for this Moblin to pass me. I'm going to try to make him charge the other way, and then I can push him backwards and make him fall into the water. He's going in a weird direction. Hello? This isn't supposed to happen. Okay. So now he's in the water, but it's okay because he can breathe. So now I'm gonna put on iron boots and make him hit me in the water. And as soon as he hits me, I'm gonna unequip my iron boots and swim up. So now I'm supposed to still, oh god, don't get hit. Okay. So now I was supposed to still take damage, but I'm in this weird state now because the game remembered that I need to take damage, that I'm invulnerable, and when I take out the hookshot, this thing is gonna happen. And Link just kind of starts spazzing out. And if I try to go in the water again, I'll just sink. I also am moving incredibly slowly and I can't speed it up. And now Link is just gonna go visit the Moblin friend who's walking into a wall. And I'm still not taking any damage. Eventually the timer will come up and I'll very slowly die. Alright, and that's it for the Blitz Exhibition.
Everyone, we have an interview with ZFG right after this. We have a $20 donation from Cat145. My boyfriend and I watch the Zeldas together every year. I've got to ask, after 10 years of being together, Alan, will you marry me? Oh, that's so cute. We have a $50 donation from Marster Chief. Hey guys, awesome marathon as always. Looking forward to the 100% Majora's Mask run. Good luck to the runners, and kill the cancers, save the animals. We have a $1,986 donation from Anonymous. In 1986, my cousin Martin came to visit us from Canada. He brought with him an NES and a very special gold cartridge that we played from dawn till dusk every night. This Christmas, I learned the terrible news that his father had died from a very preventable cancer. Let's kill this disease, AGDQ, just like y'all are killing these runs. We have a $5 donation from Televiper. Gotta hear the reader pronounce something I wrote years ago. Charlie the Chinchilla is a chimichanga chomping champion. There you go. All right, we're going over to an interview with ZFG.
Oh, all right, we're on. What's up, everyone? Welcome back to Awesome Games Done Quick 2016. I am Spike Vegeta, and I am here with my buddy Sent. Yep, thank you. That one person's awesome. All right. And I am here with our Ocarina of Time Master Quest runner, ZFG. ZFG.
Hey.
Woo, yes. ZFG, it's always a pleasure having you. I believe this is your third straight AGDQ that you've been to, and you've done four runs because you did two at 2014. Mm-hmm. I always like to kick it off with just what are your visceral thoughts of the run you just put on?
Aside from that one death at Morpha, it was mostly pretty good. A few parts were kind of sloppy, but I did about as I was expecting, aside from Morpha.
So I want to remind you guys that once again, we're taking questions all week. If you just use the hashtag AGDQ2016. Got one here from Chick Game Freak. What is the hardest trick you've had to master for this run?
So that Deca Tree to Bongo Bongo Long Warp, it started out incredibly difficult. So it was found roughly 3 months ago, and it was really found only with TAS. And we thought it was possible probably to do on console, but it would require some incredibly crazy setup. And then eventually setup was found, and it was initially very hard and very inconsistent. And then the setup was later improved, and then it became a bit more consistent. So it was initially incredibly difficult, but after some more practice, it became a lot easier. And like at the time of this run, I was actually, like within the last 2 weeks, I've been very confident with it. I'm very rarely failing in practice.
Right.
So it got a lot easier.
Got some hype going on in the room right now. Getting set up just for you guys know for the Majora's Mask 100% run, first time we've ever featured that at GDQ. Yeah, I feel like I've actually watched quite a few of your runs over the last few years. I know a lot of it's been 100%. Is this an exclusive to Master Quest, that Wrong Warp from Deku Tree to Bongo Bongo?
No, it is not exclusive to Master Quest. It will work in normal Ocarina of Time. However, there's a chance it might only be faster in Master Quest. It's still being timed right now, I think. But there's a chance it might actually be slower for normal Ocarina of Time.
Well, it looks insane, so it was definitely a highlight of the marathon. Another question here from Frozen Arts. Will you be doing other runs aside from OOT and Majora's Mask?
So I actually ran Twilight Princess about 2 years ago, and I've always wanted to go back. I really enjoyed it, but I also really enjoy Ocarina of Time a lot.
Right.
And I keep telling myself, I want to go back to Twilight Princess, and also Metroid Prime. I used to run that also, too. Mm-hmm. I really like both those games. I really want to go back to those. But Ocarina of Time is just so good, and I keep wanting to play it more and more.
So let's talk about Ocarina of Time. How many years would you say you've been running OOT for?
So I got into the speedrun community about 2006, 2007-ish, and I started actually speedrunning 2008, 2009-ish. During that time, I was just kind of messing with glitches.
Sure.
So it's been quite a while. I know a lot of people would get burned out on the speed games after such a long time, but something special about Ocarina of Time is that there's so many glitches that are like available now and keep being found, and the fact that the glitches just keep being found over time just keeps the game fresh and interesting. And there's also a lot of different categories to like do a lot of different things. Like a lot of people kind of don't like that there's a lot of categories in Ocarina of Time, but it's kind of a good thing about the game because you can do so much different stuff. And there's just such a huge amount of variety in the game.
I want to kick it over to one question here since you're talking about categories. I've got from Steven Martin here, when's Ocarina of Time RBO, or reverse boss order? He's heard it's very close.
Yes, so reverse boss order, there's actually a way you can beat Ganon without triggering the credits. It involves this like really difficult out-of-bounds hover, and then you slash Ganon from underneath the platform and then void out. And then you would kind of do reverse boss order from there. Like everything else besides that is kind of simple. But the problem is it requires, last I checked, it requires a frame-perfect, unpause-bufferable, one-shot trick that you lose like 5 to 10 minutes if you fail it. And it's really hard, and there's no visual cue, there's no audio cue. And it's really difficult, and I'd rather not do it right now.
All right, so you're saying AGDQ 2017.
Yes.
All right,
absolutely.
Good. We have our first lock of next year's marathon. So I want to look ahead to 2016 for you. You've talked about, you know, you can't get away from Ocarina of Time. Are we expecting 100%? Obviously, there are a lot of people becoming familiar with Clint Stevens now. Someone is finally challenging a record. It looks like even a couple of people. Mm-hmm. Are you tempted to go back soon, or do you want to look into other categories before
you
get
there? Yeah, so I do want to go back to 100% soon, but not immediately. So what I want to do first, I want to dabble a little bit more in Master Quest. I want to do this category called All Dungeons and Dungeon Skulltulas, also known as Dungeon Dice Monsters. And it's this category specifically made for Master Quest where it's kind of an expansion of All Dungeons where you also beat the mini dungeons, Bomb of the Well, Ice Cavern, Gerudo Training Grounds, and Ganon's Castle's Trials. And in addition to that, also get all the gold Skulltulas in the dungeons. And this is a really interesting category because you show off a lot more of the differences of Master Quest.
Sure.
As you saw in this run, like, it did show off a decent amount of differences, but you also skipped a lot of the dungeons. And so in that category, you actually see a lot more of the dungeons. It's really interesting. It's personally my second favorite category, second to 100%. And then after that, I'll probably be going back to 100% and try to improve that time again.
That's great. All of you who just, I'm sure, clicked the follow button for ZFG, you have a lot to look forward to in the way of Ocarina of Time in 2016. ZFG, I want to thank you so much for coming out once again and giving us another great run of Ocarina of Time. Oh, no, we lost him.
Daddy. Daddy's back.
Oh, this one is Daddy?
This is the Daddy? This is the Daddy.
All right, well, thank you to the hero of time himself, Daddy, for saving us once again. I'm going to kick it one more time over to Cent to show off some more great prizes that I believe you can get during if you donate during this game and the next one. Again, Majora's Mask 100% coming up right after this.
Hey, thanks for having me, Spike. ZFG, wonderful run, by the
way.
Thank you. You are correct. These are all prizes that will be that were available during ZFG's run and will continue to be available through Majora's Mask, 100%. Mm-hmm. So first off, we have this wonderful watercolor painting of the Skull Kid from Majora's Mask, sent
awesome
to us by Nathan Call. Really, really wonderful stuff here. Very creepy. He's captured that kind of childlike...
So if you like something that's going to keep you up all night, all right, good deal.
Yeah. All right, so next up, this is a Kikui. You might know that if you played Skyward Sword, but if you didn't, how would you?
Nope.
I got an answer for you,
it's
Spike.
It's adorable either way. Whoa, okay.
Yeah, we got a copy here of Legend of the Hero from Kari Fry, featuring illustrations from Kari Fry and signed by Kari Fry. Of course.
You know, again,
let me just pop it open here. We got wonderful illustrations of all kinds of Legend of Zelda characters, plants, monsters, and even a timeline. So you two can chart.
Oh, good. We can try to analyze the timeline.
Yeah, you can try to figure it out. It'll be all kinds of fun. You know, we got some Skull Keys in there.
So I love the style.
Oh yeah, no, her artwork is very beautiful. Hopefully, it's showing up on camera. And
I'm sure you guys can't see it. It looks great. So.
Yeah, and unfortunately, camera angle's not too great. And as a side bonus,
the dust jacket
is a wonderful poster.
There you go.
Yeah. So, now, speaking of Majora's Mask 100% coming up, and this might be a little hard to see on camera, so I'm going to reach out as far as I can. This is a collectible Majora's Mask 3D pin, only available to people who pre-ordered a Majora's Mask 3D bundle with the DS.
Ah, okay.
It's pretty cool.
Donated by your Jamil?
It's donated by Ken.
Oh, okay.
This was donated by E-Mister. I apologize. Because our next prize... also in the vein of Majora's Mask, was donated by Ken. Huge shout-outs to him. We have another Majora's Mask 3DS.
Of course, the grand prize, as we pointed out before.
Right, it's actually running from Majora's Mask all the way through to the end of the marathon, so $50 from now until then gets you into the drawing for this 3DS. But it's not just the 3DS.
Loaded on Zelda prizes.
Oh, yeah, we are loaded. It comes with this beautiful 3DS carrying bag featuring the Triforce, as well as, and this is pretty cool, a limited edition Skull Kid figurine, also only available with a pre-purchase of the Majora's Mask 3DS bundle.
So we have a ton of great prizes here. I just have to ask, do you know of a minimum amount to be in the drawing for all of these?
Well, $50 would get you into the minimum amount.
Yeah.
The 3DS figure and pouch are $50. The pin is $15. And the copy of Legend of the Hero and this wonderful watercolor drawing are 10 each.
And 10? 5?
He was
a dollar?
He actually went out earlier during the
marathon. Oh, he went out earlier.
That was the setup for Legend of the Hero.
That was the setup. Okay. Now we can. Well,
he's still
whoever
adorable.
Want him, congrats to him. All right, sick.
Oh, thank you for having me, Spike.
Yeah, Seth, thank you so much. Yep. Again, I just want to give a huge shout-out. We haven't really taken the time to everybody who's donated prizes during this event.
Oh,
lots of really awesome, great prizes. Big shout-outs to them.
Certainly. We try to showcase them as much as we can.
There we go.
They're giving you the hand.
I don't know if they do. We're getting that set up. We're getting hyped. Guys, that is simply one part, and we haven't even scratched the surface of 3D Zelda tonight. It is time for Majora's Mask 100%. We got four of the absolute best players in the world. Let's send it over to them for Majora's Mask 100%.
Hello, everyone. My name is Brittany, and I'm going to be with you guys for the Majora's Mask run. It should be a really exciting run. We've got a co-op between four people doing 100%. So get excited. Just as a reminder, AGDQ 2016's live stream is powered by Twitch. Before we get started, I'm just going to read a couple of donations. Hey, listen, randomly finding Runner Guy's 2013 AGDQ run of OOT is what introduced me to AGDQ and SGDQ. Donation goes to Runner Guy's Choice, and that was $500 from Matthew. $20 from Anonymous, love this event. My mom was diagnosed with colon cancer last year, but thanks to early detection, she is now cancer-free. Keep up the good work. $70 from Craig. Been watching since SGDQ 2012, and every runner continues to blow my mind year after year with their talent. Put the money towards MK64, two players, one controller. Evil Tim donated $50, and he said, if I type words in this box, will someone read it? Yes. Sometimes. We have a $1,000 donation from Laser Bomb. Majora's Mask was one of my favorite Zeldas as a kid. Great to see it in this marathon. Putting this money towards naming Edge as Arby's, because who needs a time machine when you can just make something Arby's instead? Shoutouts to Bulls of Steve and Glitter Tex. Just a reminder, guys, all of the money made during this marathon is going to the Prevent Cancer Foundation.
What?
Lay across.
Lay across.
Oh.
No way.
You're boring.
I'm sorry. No, no way. It's not gonna happen.
We have a $256 donation from Principa. He says
$64
for each of the runners in this co-op run. Majora's Mask was and is to this day my and my husband's favorite Zelda game. We lost my mother-in-law to cancer almost 9 years ago, and although she didn't always get our love of gaming, she was always supportive of it. Thank you for helping to make a future where no one will have to lose a loved one to cancer.
Amen.
And remember to save those animals.
Let's do this.
Got it.
All right.
We're fine. I won't need that for now.
Yeah, I'm gonna put it back.
I got mine here.
Don't turn the wheel off.
I know. Let's just leave that here. Good.